I mean, that's what women do, human women. They're not like chimps. They're selective maters. So as far as men are concerned, and maybe as far as women are concerned too, women are nature. It's not a metaphor. It's like they're the thing that stops you from reproducing, let's say. And that's partly why they make you self-conscious when you reject it. It's like they're the portal to immortality. That's another way of looking at it. They are nature. It's not like they represent it. They are nature in the most direct possible way. So, like, is that a right way of looking at the world? It's difficult to make an alternative case if you think from a Darwinian perspective. Now, there's a metaphorical element to it, too, because you can also project it on that which lies outside of the patriarchy, which is also why women get in trouble with men sometimes, because men can easily get them confused, right? It's easy for women to be the chaotic thing that doesn't fit in the hierarchy, and women are always complaining about that, right? And as they should, it's a constant battle. But what's happened, for better or worse, is that we've been able to take that initial social cognitive architecture to build a system of abstraction on top of that, to use the same basic categories to explain how to behave, and it worked. So, it's mind-boggling. It's mind-boggling to me that that works.
Are you familiar with the theories of embodied cognition? And like George Lakoff and his metaphor theory of thought, basically?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I think what you're saying is the same thing, right? We have these categories that emerge from our lived experience as humans in our human embodiment.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
And because these are actually the only tools we have, we use them in recombination with each other, with themselves, if necessary, in modification. But we use them as ways of making sense of the world. Even our scientific models are predicated on the embodied experiences.
That's a tougher one. That's a tougher one, because I do think that that science does have there's a qualitative difference. It is, in some sense, stepping outside of the mythological framework. You know, and it's because it's this really powerful technique. It's like, okay, what is the nature of our shared experience? Now, that's not exactly what science is about. It's more like, if we behave in such and such a way, something will happen. We're going to interpret that from a subjective perspective, like a personal perspective, let's say. But what happens if we get 100 people to do that, and they all observe the outcome, and then they all tell a story about it, and then we take what's common across the stories. It's like, oh, well, that's interesting. We get a new way of describing things. Well, is that true? Well, then you get back into the problem of what constitutes truth. Is it useful? That we also don't know that, because we don't have the time frame across which to analyze it yet. Like, we're staking our survival on the presupposition that it's useful. But it's like, you know, there wouldn't be constant bouts of apocalyptic thinking if we didn't have our doubts about it, right? And it's certainly an anomaly in the natural world. Well, no other creature has science. It's like, they did perfectly well without it. Maybe science is fatal. I mean, it could easily be fatal. So, you know, and someone who's a scientist in the sort of ideological sense, would say, well, even if it's fatal, it was still true. It's like, well, it depends on how you define truth. Like, if you're willing to say that fatal is true, well, then go ahead. But I think that's not a good definition of truth. And that's where our disagreement really lies. You have your definition, and I have my definition. I think my definition is Darwinian. So you have to contend with that if you're a scientist. But you might dispute that, although it's not clear to me how you would dispute that. But, well, we've already run through that argument. It gets tangled up at the bottom, you know. And I also think, well, part of the problem with the view that only what is objectively observable is real, which you can have a science without that presupposition. You could say only what is objectively true is uniquely useful and valuable. But it's, you know, it's part of a bunch of things that are uniquely useful and valuable. But let's not discount it. It's also dangerous, so we got to keep an eye on it, you know. It's a big tool. Well, that's a perfectly reasonable thing to do. What do you take the next step and you say, only that? Well, then I also think another way. It's like, why are you claiming only that? You say, well, it's because I'm pursuing truth. And I think, oh, you're sure about that, are you? You actually think that, like, you're on this, you're sure that you're on this pristine path. And all those other people who aren't, they're deluded or there's something wrong with them. But you're on this pristine path. You're so sure of that. I don't think you know anything about yourself if you think that. It's like, all scientists are devoted to the truth. What truth? Maybe they're devoted to the purpose of demonstrating that there's no meaning in life so that they don't have to bear any moral responsibility. It's like, why not that? Oh, well, we wouldn't think that. It's like, well, I'm a psychoanalyst. I might think that. Because whenever anybody says to me, I believe X, I think, what does that allow you not to believe? I'm for X. What are you against? Well, I've thought about this a lot. It's like, oh, it's a catastrophe that the war between science and religion blows our capacity to believe in transcendent meaning. It demolishes our ability to believe in transcendent meaning. Isn't that a catastrophe? Sort of the Nietzschean viewpoint. It's like, I don't know if it's a catastrophe. Because then I think, all right, well, under what conditions would you be motivated to accept that catastrophe? Well, you could say your life is meaningful, but meaning comes at a price. The price is basically moral. And part of that moral price is truth and responsibility. You have to bear that. Okay, it's like, yeah, you get meaning, but now you've got some work to do. You don't get to regard your actions as trivial. You don't get to rationalize your errors of speech as casual and forgivable. None of that. You get the whole burden that goes with meaning. Or you can say, well, nothing's meaningful. Well, Dostoevsky figured this out a long time ago. If there's no God, if there's no moral values, everything is permitted. It's like, okay, maybe that's what you want. Maybe your whole argument, even though you don't know it, maybe that whole argument, of which you're only a part of, is actually predicated on the desire to demolish the necessity for truth and responsibility. It's like, well, you could say no. It's like, okay, but, you know, it's not like science has always been put to purposes that we would regard as ethical. And then you also have to ask, well, what allows us to ask the question of whether or not science is put to ethical purposes? What's the framework for evaluation? Well, it's not scientific. Well, does it exist? Solzhenitsyn said something interesting about the Nuremberg judgment, because he thought of that as like a pinnacle event in the 20th century. And I can understand this, because, like, you know, there's this Cartesian, one of the things Descartes did, hypothetically, was to try to doubt everything till he found something he couldn't doubt. And what he couldn't doubt was the fact that he thinks. Now, that's a translation, so I don't really know if he meant I think. Whatever. He had this process of radical doubt. Well, I did that too before I wrote Maps of Meaning, except I didn't know that Descartes had done it. I was trying to think, what do I actually believe? What's unassailably true for me? And I thought, pain. Pain's true. It's really hard. You can't argue yourself out of pain. It's like, when it happens, it's real. No matter what you say about subjectivity, it's like you're running around screaming, so who cares what you say? And then I thought, well, the infliction of pain is real. And then I thought, well, if pain is, like, pain is unpleasant. It's got that quality about it. You know, and I so that was good. And then there was another process of argumentation that led me to conclude that what constituted evil was the infliction of unnecessary pain. And for me, like, so not only, like, if I'm really evil, I'm going to inflict pain in a way that not only damages whoever I'm inflicting, it also damages me, and that's fine. It's like the shootings in the high schools. It's like, why don't they just shoot themselves to begin with? Why go to all the trouble? Well, try answering that. You should read some of the writings of the Columbine killers, man. They'll make the hair on the back of your neck stand up. You know, you cannot believe what those kids wrote. It's uncanny what they were thinking, truly. So, well, they're motivated by something. Well, what? Well, it's something satanic from an archetypal perspective, you know. So for me, what ended up at the bottom of reality was, it's wrong to inflict unnecessary pain. So pain even that doesn't serve your own purposes even. That's the Nuremberg judgment, fundamentally. It's like, there are things that are wrong. Okay, are you going to accept that or not? Well, if you accept that, there's a place you go. And if you don't accept that, there's another place you go. And we already saw what happened when people go to that place. And so you can say, well, that's irrelevant. Okay, fine. You pay the price for your belief. So will other people. So, for, and you know, so that's why Solzhenitsyn is at least in part an admirer of the Nuremberg Judgment. It's like there are things that are archetypally evil. You don't get to escape from them because of culture. You don't get to escape from them because of the particulars of the situation. Well, you can make a strong case that that's victor talk and revenge. Fair enough, but when I wandered through the Holocaust literature and the literature on the Japanese invasion of China and the literature on the Stalinist camps, that was sufficiently convincing for me. It's like, no, not there. That's not the right place to go. Is that a scientific judgment? No.